Victor Sims, the Zed History. Now let's talk about power, and specifically the most powerful black man in Northern Rhodesia in the 1950s. He was a man whose legacy was so profound that even after death, the mere mention of his name was just about treasonable for the most part of the post-independence era in Zambia. A Bemba aristocrat who could have possibly been the president of Zambia in 1964 in place of Kenneth Kaunda himself. His name was Lawrence Chola Katilungu, leader of the trade union movement in Northern Rhodesia, and believed to have been the main player in the creation and organization of trade unionism in pre-independence Zambia. With the help of some rather controversial figures and a few prominent men, Katilungu grew an African workers' union from less than 10 in 1947 to over 19,000 by 1949, making him not only a force to reckon with, but a feared and very powerful man. But how did one man come to wield such great power?
At 1,400 feet below ground level, Queen Elizabeth the Queen Mother had an unusual experience when she visited workers in the Roan Antelope copper mine in Northern Rhodesia. This was one of the last engagements of Her Majesty's 15-day tour of the Federation of Rhodesia and Nyasaland. Wearing a white dust coat over her grey dress, and with plastic helmet and cap lamp, the Queen Mother watched with the greatest interest the workings of a mine which employs over 10,000 workers, 8,000 of them Africans. Before leaving, there were warm royal greetings for miners who had been with the company for many years.
In the early 1900s, speculations on the effectiveness of a strike by organized African laborers was rife, especially in newsletters from the South. Organized African laborers. The phrase almost sounded absurd or an oxymoron at best. But in Northern Rhodesia, there was no need to speculate. Strikes by Africans were actually very real. In the 1930s, for example, for several weeks, there were organized strikes by African mine workers at five of the big six copper mines on the Copper Belt. Production at these mines was crippled, and the former Northern Rhodesia Minister of Labor, Sir Roy Walensky, estimated the cost of the strikes on the Federation as over $132,000 a day in taxes payable to the federal and territorial government. Coupled with about $2.2 million the mining companies were losing in average weekly profits, the African mine workers' strikes were indeed an expensive inconvenience, one that had to be curbed forthwith, especially that copper was the financial backbone of the troubled Federation of Rhodesia and Nyasaland. But how did things escalate to such a level? To be sure, colonial authorities had done their best to preserve a structure of labor relations based upon ethnic principles of representation by promoting the system of tribal elders as far back as the 1930s. And by adding to it boss boys and works committees during the Second World War, it was conveniently purported that African workers were not ready for workers' unions. Ironically, despite all the effort, the African trade union was actually the brainchild of the boogeyman of the Northern Rhodesian European settlers, the dreaded Colonial Office in London. existing as it were under the British Labour government of the 1940s. And in 1947, much to the horror and dismay of white settlers and the powers that were in the mining companies in northern Rhodesia, the Colonial Office sent a red-headed Scottish trade unionist by the name of William Comrie to northern Rhodesia, specifically to the Copperbelt region. His task, assist union-minded Africans to organize. Now, Comrie was a suave and self-assured gentleman who wore tailored suits and kept a neat mustache that sat well on his blunt, carefree face. In other words, he looked anything but a trade unionist. Comrie's task was made simple by the fact that Africans were already anxious to have trade unions. Comrie thus simply held meetings with key African personalities and explained the principles of trade unionism. To be sure, even before the arrival of Comrie, industrial agitation had already set the ball in motion at the cost of at least 6 African lives. Now, Zambia's Copperbelt province, which adjoins the Katanga region of the Democratic Republic of Congo, is well known for its rich copper deposits and of course for being the backbone of the Northern Rhodesian economy as well as the Federation of Rhodesia and Nyasaland. What is less well known, however, is the fact that the history of unionism as well as modern political history of Zambia can be traced to the late 1930s when the Copperbelt province emerged as the economic heart of the entire region. In the 1930s, mining towns on the Copperbelt brought large numbers of Africans into close association and recurrent conflict with a small number of dominant Europeans. And soon, both the Africans and white Europeans began to put pressure on colonial government and mining companies with different demands. It was thus in the mining towns that popular African discontent with colonial rule first found effective expression through recognized leaders. And because of the mobility of mine workers between urban and rural areas, political awareness would soon spread across the entire country. Without a doubt, opening of the mines and growth of the copper belt transformed the foreign trade of northern Rhodesia, with the contribution of copper rising from 30 to over 90% between 1930 and 1933. Furthermore, during the Second World War, the Allies made heavy demands on the copper mines such that by 1945, Northern Rhodesia was firmly established as one of the world's major copper producers, contributing about 1/8 or roughly 4.5% of the non-communist world's total copper production. In addition, increasing mining activities on the copper belt provided a new market within the region for migrant labor. By 1930, many of the indigenous peoples, mainly the Lamba, had been moved to new land, and by 1931, the Europeans on the copper belt, mostly from South Africa, numbered over 4,000. This was nearly equal to the total number of Europeans in the entire territory in 1924. The unskilled mine labor was of course supplied by the Africans, who were mostly Bemba-speaking peoples of the northeast who already had some experience with mining in the Katanga. After 1930s, when activities were at their height, there were nearly 22,000 Africans at work on the copper mines. This was over one-third, or 34%, of the total number of Africans employed in Northern Rhodesia. And by 1943, the number rose to 33,000, with the growth of railway traffic providing a further source of employment. Now, with such rapid population increase, it was not long before there was a problem. Worse still, for many years, both European and African mine workers on the Copperbelt were kept mobile and did not settle permanently in towns or mines. Moreover, African miners got low wages on the convenient assumption that they only needed money to pay taxes and buy a few clothes. On the other hand, their families back home were assumed to subsist primarily on their own produce. Thus, African workers were all paid and housed as single men. Outwardly, it was portrayed as though the desire for Africans to maintain ties with their villages was meant for them to support their relatives and maintain, as it were, their tribal identity. However, in reality, the fear of detribalization lay deeper not only for the mines, but for colonial government itself. Like elsewhere, the colonial government in Northern Rhodesia regarded what they referred to as settled communities of urban, semi-civilized Africans as a threat to white domination. And they were right. In 1935, for the first time in history, African mine workers on the Copper Belt went on strike. First at Mufulira, and then at Nkana and Roan Antelope mines. At Roan, the indiscriminate use of force by the police provoked rioting, which left 6 African strikers dead. Elsewhere, there was very little violence, and the strikers soon went back to work. However, brief and seemingly as ineffective as it was, the strike served to show that Africans, despite not being unionized, were already conscious of a common interest and were capable of organizing concerted resistance within the urban environment. Indeed, the strike was the first organized industrial agitation in Northern Rhodesia and is viewed by some as the first overt action against colonial rule. The strike caught the attention of a number of African townsmen, including a young, astute member of the royal clan of the Bemba people. But this was no ordinary young man. He was the grandson of Chief Chipalo himself and a member of the Avena Ngandu clan, and thus related to the Chitimkulu, the paramount chief of the Bemba people. And his arrival on the Copper Belt would change everything. Lawrence Chola Katilungu arrived in Kitwe in 1936, just after the strike of 35. Born in the northern province of Northern Rhodesia, Nomingo, in January 1914, Lawrence was only 22 years old when he joined the mines on the Copper Belt. He was educated at Catholic mission schools up to Form 2 level and was employed as a teacher briefly before he joined the mines. After observing the poor working conditions of the workers and being far better educated than the average miner at the time, Lawrence immediately realized the need for a trade union. And it was around that time that he made a lifelong friend, a Lozi prince, the son of a Litunga by the name of Godwin Mbukusita Lewon. During this period, many European miners were equally mobile workers, with many returning to South Africa when the conditions seemed more favorable there. In response, mining companies boosted the wages of Europeans to induce them to stay on the Copper Belt. As such, unwittingly, the militancy of white underground workers and artisans, their formation of a union, and their successful strikes soon inspired militancy among the Africans. At the time, the intellectual capabilities of Africans was mocked and underestimated. However, Katilungu and his friend Mbukusita Lewanika, who worked in supervisory and clerical positions, had the opportunity to closely observe how the union was formed, how strikes were organized, and how labor negotiations were carried out during the strike of the white miners. Katilungu and the other Africans very quickly absorbed the lessons and organized their own strike in 1940. only months after the white miners had won their own strike against the mine. However, as was a common practice, the government resorted to massive force in order to intimidate the miners. Worse still, the British were in the middle of the Second World War, a life and death struggle with Nazi Germany, and a strike in an industry that produced a strategic material, copper, that was used in the manufacture of electrical equipment and ammunition was unacceptable. Troops were deployed and 17 miners died in a bloody confrontation. Nevertheless, African miners were not deterred. They were resolved to form a union, come what may. Moreover, though the mines had tried to use the tribal system to control the miners, this too had failed. Furthermore, when the miners were moved from the barracks into external housing units, it was no longer possible to allocate them housing on tribal bases. Around the same time, Godwin Bokisite-Lewanika, who was the human resource officer catering for the African miners, began the Northern Rhodesian African Welfare Association, which eventually became the African National Congress, from which sprung the United National Independence Party. But unionism in Northern Rhodesia did not get much notable traction until the red-haired Scot met with Katilungu and a 26-year-old radical African nationalist known as Matthew Deluxe Nkolomo.